Welcome to Calvary Conversations. My name is Mariah, and today we are in studio with a special guest. But I am here with my dad, Pastor Craig Roders. Hey. Woo! And we are here with a special guest, Pastor Brian Sumner.
Yeah.
The man, the myth. The
yes. Thank you for joining us. We just did a message with you, so.
I feel like, we've hung out for the last 2 days.
Yes,
I flew in yesterday. We hung out nonstop. We did 2 services this morning.
You never come back.
We just ate mod pizza. We're doing a podcast.
You just got cactus in tonight. You
just got cactus. Yeah. So, guys, it's awesome to be out here hanging out, though.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. We're happy to have you. Mm-hmm. And it's been cool because we did a podcast with you on Skype last year. And so it was just cool because my dad and I were both like, we need to get Brian Sumner to come to our church. Mm-hmm. And so there was a lot of good time of like ministry, and it was...
Because Brian's a fighter.
He's a fighter. Like I was. Church. He taught us how to speak English.
He fight for the Lord now.
I'm just going to laugh at you guys.
I know. We're just going, wondering.
Are we starting?
Well, people don't realize, though, when you get done preaching, it's like you're so focused.
Yeah.
That when you're done, there's almost this like energy where you can just relax for a bit.
Yeah.
So we're all kind of in that silly stage of just eating and full of energy. So
yes.
Who knows where we're going to be led?
Who
by
knows?
Now.
But it's going to be fun.
When we have the service tonight, it'll be
yeah. So if you guys want, you guys can check out the services or the service when you shared your testimony and talked about marriage. That will be in the description below. But before we get into anything else, we should have you pray. So.
Yeah,
we
do. Get it.
Welcome to Holy
Father,
Spirit.
Father, I just thank you. And we just do invite you, Holy Spirit, just to direct us. And Lord, we thank you that we can be serious as a heart attack when we need to be. We can also have fun, Lord, as you said in your word, that you had more joy than all your fellows. So, Father, help us. Lord, we want to be joyful, but we don't want to grieve you by going too far. Mm-hmm. But we just want to have just fun, and we want to be real. And I just thank you. That's what I see when I see Brian. I just see someone who loves God and is real and talks truthfully and speaks the truth in love. And so, Lord, bless this podcast. Direct him, direct us, and help us to not talk too much, but let him talk. And at least I'm speaking that for me. And we just give you this time. And, Lord, as your word says, whatever you commit to you, the Lord, it shall be established. Your kingdom come, your will be done in this podcast. In Jesus' most powerful name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So I butchered the bio in the last one, but basically you're an evangelist, you're a pastor, you're an author of the book Never Fails, which we encourage everyone to get. And
Death by Marriage.
Death by Marriage. And you're also a husband to your wife, Tracy, and you have your 3 children and your daughter-in-law. So how is life? Just
a lot going on. Yeah. I mean, you know, for anyone who knows anything about me, skating all those years, then having a crazy marriage, then God restoring us, putting us back together, having the 3 kids, and now just traveling, you know, dealing with my wife's mother passing away a month or so ago. And we'd already talked prior and said, hey, you know what? Am I just going to go travel as needed? So I'm out here for a few days. I'm in Texas a few days in a week. And aside from that, I'm just preaching locally, trying to write this evangelism book. And I love coming out for like 2 days like this, just hang out, you know, be around the body of Christ, hearing your church worship and ministering with people today. So it's aside from the cactuses, it's good. And even that isn't that bad. They're all in my hands still.
Yeah. The little teeny ones.
Yeah. But I wanted to ask you some questions. So we'll just start off with talking about, because your book, it says engaged, courting, single.
Yeah.
So we'll start with single because that's kind of where it starts, right, for everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just, what was some advice you would give to your single self? Brian,
don't sleep with people.
Mm-hmm.
There we go.
There you go.
Single people need to know that because we're living in a day and age where it's been loosed so much and it's just so casual and we're in church and we're around people and, you know, we're hearing the worship and we're engaging, but we're not setting boundaries anymore.
Yeah.
And I say that as a jest, but completely serious as well. I would tell my single self, look, God has given you a call. Whoever you're going to marry, he's given a call to. You guys are going to be cleft together one day. Mm. Why get into anything with anyone? And by not doing that, like my son said one time, well, Dad, if we weren't meant to do stuff, why would he have these emotions? And said, well, that's for you to practice patience.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, you hit puberty, your body starts changing, you start liking someone, things begin to blossom, you guys grow together. Now you're 17, 18, 19. That time till you get married, that's a pedigree.
Mm.
I had friends one time who said to me, you know, well, we've been sleeping together and yeah, we slipped up, but you know, And I said, how would you know you would never have affairs in your marriage? Well, why would we do that? Well, you're having sex outside of marriage now.
Yeah.
And you love each other, and it might just be you two, but it's not God honoring. So as a single person, I'd say, focus on what God has and allow God to bring someone into your path. Mm. I sat with a couple out there today who were on their second marriage and they're wrestling through some things. And I just simply said, you know, the compatibility scale here is more, what are you guys called to do? As you do that together in serving him, that's what's going to grow. That's what I tell myself as a single person. Who's that girl going to be? What's going to blossom? That's where God's going to lead. Mm. It's that easy, but our impatience gets in the way.
Yeah.
Our flesh gets in the way. There's so many great Christian things we can be doing now.
Yeah.
But then you're seeing that girl all the time. There's passion all the time. You're going to want to jump ahead. And
yeah.
And it's crazy, like you're saying, we were talking about just getting back to the Bible, but how like even someone's telling me like Christian mingle things, a lot of the people on there will say, I don't have a problem with having sex
before,
as long as you're, you know, as long as you're somewhat committed. I mean, that's just a new sad normal. It's not biblical, but it seems to be the normal for Christians now, is to kick the tires, especially if someone's been married before, to say, hey, I gotta make sure. And that,
I mean,
I heard one Christian counselor said that it makes relationships are hard enough as it is, but when you add sex to the mix before marriage, then it makes all these crazy, you've aroused love before, like you were saying, from Psalm, you've aroused love before it's time. So now you got all these emotions you shouldn't have, like you said, shouldn't have given yourself completely yet to them. And now you're trying to navigate that. And now, and then there's the thing of, well, maybe this isn't the right one, but I feel kind of committed, or I'm pregnant, so I have to, maybe you're coming back to a marriage that shouldn't be. But you've
got to realize when you're physical with someone, I get spiritually there's a cleaving and there's a unifying of souls. But anyone you've ever been with before you're a Christian, you were with that person. You looked at them a certain way. You had these experiences a certain way. If I, you know, to go BC, if I go and hang out with someone that used to be my wife's friend, a girl that she used to drive over to hang out with me, who was a bit younger than she was, and we hung out, we haven't seen that person in years. But if we see her, that's going to be in all the backs of their heads. Oh, you guys were physical years ago. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, there's a connection there. Why go and connect to God's son or daughter if you're claiming to be a Christian and opening that door? And it's just, and that's going to come into your marriage. You're going to have to tell your spouse whatever there's insecurities, and do yourself a favor and don't.
Yeah.
I love what Josh McDowell said. He said it pretty good. This is a long time. It was like 40 years ago. He said, men don't like to marry used furniture, but they sure like to be in the antiquing business before marriage. Is that so sad? I mean, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
So think,
so
you don't want someone messing with your wife before you married her. And so why should you? You got to kind of think, and honor God, of course, first, but also think about, this is, could be, if you don't marry this person, this is someone else's wife, probably, you know.
Mm-hmm. And it says, honor the older women as your mother and the younger women as your sister. Take that wherever you want to go. But I mean, do you want to be making out with someone technically, spiritually in your family?
Yeah.
And this is God's daughter. It's like me putting a bottle of poison on there, and hey, it's wrapped up good. So she looks attractive. There's passion there. She's fun. You engage in all the right things.
Mm-hmm.
But where you're going is going to, you know, you're dealing with God. This is his daughter or son. You're defiling in a sense. Yeah. So
it's funny you say, I laugh because, not because it's funny, but I talked to, so I was a youth pastor for 21 years. And I said, so this guy goes, I'm going to kiss girls. You can't tell me I shouldn't kiss right away. I said, well, can you, and I read that scripture, can you kiss your sister? Dude, that's sick. I said, well, that's kind of why God's using that metaphor to say, until the marriage bed is holy, until you've committed. That's kind of how God views it.
You don't know if you're going to marry them, because I know there's some people, if they're playing the, if they're just trying to be like, they're like, well, I think I will marry them. Like, I can see myself.
I'm probably going to.
Yeah, I'm probably going to. But it's like, I have known so many people where it's like, my sister-in-law, she was engaged. Like, I was almost engaged. Like, you literally think that. And then when you add sex in the mix of it, you're not thinking straight, because you've already joined yourself with them.
I know.
What is that bond? What is it with like a mom and her baby?
Oh, pitocin. Is it pitocin? What's it called?
Oh, man.
I can't.
The word.
It's
whatever
when you
it is.
Breastfeed, there's a chemical. But it bonds you. The same thing when you have sex with. When a woman has sex, it bonds her to the man.
Yeah. And then you see
there's
that.
There's
got to, like,
be a science to
so
it.
So many young adults, I forget the word. They know that they shouldn't be with someone, but because they're being physical with them, there's something in their mind where it's like, well, I mean, because they are one. And so it's just, it makes me really sad to see, like, so advice for single people who are like, okay, I don't want to do that, but I've just been, I can't help it. Or they'll either say, I can't help it. What would you say? Because whenever people hear the word boundaries, like you bring up, they hate that. They're like, don't even tell me that. We're rebellious.
That's our nature.
Mm-hmm. Or they'll say it's legalism.
But what are some things or like advice that you would give people who are like, okay, I get it now. You're saying it's wrong, or fornication, you know, it says fornicators, adulterers.
It is wrong. Sex outside of marriage is wrong. I preach that of 1 Corinthians 7. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The issues of which you wrote, those sleeping around, that's why you need a spouse. So to them, I would say, get real Christian friends. I don't mean legalistically, but get around some people that also don't want to sleep with everyone. Exactly. They want to honor God, do things in groups.
Yeah.
Why go put yourself in harm's way by being alone with someone? I mean, if you're hanging out with someone you're attracted to and they smell good and you're close to them and you're watching a movie, things are going to happen. You're going to make suggestive comments, especially men, you know, young men. I think even if my own son, you know, he just got married at 21. Mm-hmm. He was 20 when he got married, but now he's 21 a few months ago. But the more he would be around his girlfriend by himself, there's more opportunity there. Mm-hmm. Oh, so as families, we were really there saying, hey, you need to draw the line. So I'd say, get around accountability. Mm-hmm. You should be planted in a church anyway around leadership. Mm-hmm. And then put Christ first.
Yeah.
I mean, you can overcome. You don't need to fall into this and call sin, sin.
Yep.
You want to be able to offer yourself to your spouse as a virgin. I mean, that's the goal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So.
I'm sorry, can I say?
Yep.
But it's like you said about Dobson, about the nightlight.
Yeah.
But Dobson also said once, I heard him speak, he said, if you fornicate with your wife, because women are a lot more sensitive, men can say, oh, I blew it, but I'm sorry. But they kind of carry that into sort of saying, like, now since we fornicate and it was wrong, even though we now get married, they still have that kind of guilt with sex. Mm. So it kind of brings, besides the thing, if you can break the covenant before, why can't you break
the commitment? You've tarnished it already.
But you sort of, and not that God can't redeem that, but it sort of brings another hurdle to deal with as a marriage, because now you got to tell your wife, okay, it's legal now. It's all right now. Okay. It's the marriage bed is not defined. It's holy, but it takes, it's some women, he said, their mind's a lot harder to go, oh, it's been bad for maybe 6 months, but now it's good. And women aren't as fast as men to say, oh, it's under the blood, you know, give
it
up.
The man's not covering it. I mean, he's taking advantage of her. She's, I mean, Proverbs 5:6-7, read it. I mean, it's about a woman drawing a man into her bed.
Yeah.
It's dangerous. And then it's like, and here's a man pursuing the woman. No.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
My kids listening, guys, trust in the Lord, lean not in your own understanding, you know, make it that far. I believe my son and his wife fully did, you know, they were around a lot of people. I'm not saying they weren't challenged and tempted, I'm sure. You know, I mean, imagine being that age and going through all that. I mean, it's a powerful thing, like, praise God, but it's possible that God wouldn't say it.
Amen.
Well, we're like, I don't know if you ever saw The Godfather, but we're like, we follow them. They would be at our house and they could never, we were never alone. And people called us legalists, but they said we would have struggled. But we just, they were always with us. They always hung around.
Why wouldn't you do that?
I mean, I remember there's times with my ex where I'm like, my family was there and I was still having thoughts and like could easily do something I shouldn't. And I was like, my family is in the same room. I'm like, I couldn't imagine if I was allowed to be in my room by like, or in a car or whatever. I mean, some people, they can, you know, whatever. We're not trying to be legalistic about it, but it's just like.
Not very many, trust.
But if people are really honest, because you always say how far is too far. They've gone farther than, like, this one guy saying, this one pastor, he's like, if your body is preparing itself for sex, you've gone too far. It's like, y'all know what I mean by that. No one likes to talk that way, but it's true.
Yeah.
Same thing with pornography, masturbation, like all these things. The church is now telling you, like, oh, it's fine, just in case you're not thinking about someone or whatever.
It's more like dealing with your feelings than dealing with the issue. And like Leonard Ravenhill used to say, everything the church doesn't like, it calls legalism. So if I'm like, oh, I'm suddenly getting overweight, but pastor, don't let me eat the donuts, as Alistair Begg would say, and then you take the donuts away, I'm like, what are you doing? You're a legalist, but you're meant to be helping me. I mean, the church is a place.
Yeah.
So the next generation, guys, please look at that woman or that man as God's son or daughter and honor him. And then don't keep saying, how far can we go? Because there's no we until you are one. So you're courting right now.
Exactly.
And I like, it's funny. I don't know, it was Paul Washer said, if you call me a legalist, You're calling me a heretic because a true legalist believes if I do this and this and this, I'm righteous. It makes me saved. Mm. He says, no. But if you do it because, like you said, discipline, then it's just you're doing it, as Jesus said, if you love me, obey my commands. Make sure. So if you're doing it to be righteous, you're like, this makes me righteous. I'm holy now. I'm saved because I don't do this or smoke or chew. But he says, if you do it out of love for God, that's not legalism. That's called discipline.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And he says, so a legalist believes these works save me. But a true Christian says, I don't eat the donuts. I don't have sex because I love Jesus. And I trust. Yeah. This is the other thing is you have to remember, too. When Jesus says, thou shalt not, it's not to rob us like, ooh, this will really make Brian or Craig messed up. You know, No, it's because sex before marriage is sinful. It hurts. Yeah. It causes death. Yep. It hurts you. It's not to rob you. It's to protect you. So you have a blessing.
If I hung out with anyone by myself, like went to eat somewhere, and I'm sitting there with that person and my wife's there, and my wife was to go to the restroom. Wouldn't that just feel like, okay, this is weird. You guys are alone together after what you've done in the past. I mean, that's a bond that's just, even if it was funny and you were way more mature and it was like, whatever, but it shouldn't ever even come up, you know, like, why go there?
And that's what they say. They say if like a man is like alone with a woman or whatever, even if you don't like them, they say like sex is in the air. You can't think that, oh, I'll be fine. Like, I mean, that's the issue is like you even brought up today. Where you're strong, take heed lest you fall. Like that, the pride of thinking, oh, I would never, like we wouldn't, you can't say that. I mean, King David thought that, like you're saying, but again, what was it? He wasn't doing his calling when where kings were at war.
Yeah.
He was at the palace.
Was and Tom.
And I love, and because Peep and Tom the reason why I bring this up is because I think people probably don't, when they're listening to this podcast, they're like, oh, I'm going to turn it off because this is for young kids, right? This is for young people. But King David, he was like probably 50, they say possibly. Mm-hmm. And I love the verse. It's 2 Timothy 2:22. It says, flee from anything that stimulates youthful lust. Mm-hmm. And so when people hear that, like, well, I'm not a youth, but like we were joking about
youthful lust, exactly, feelings you would have had.
Yeah, exactly. And that's where it's like nowadays,
in the old folks home is crazy.
I know, nowadays the old folks home, there's like so much immorality.
Just so you guys know, because I didn't know this till we went to Mod Pizza and these guys explained it to me.
Apparently, it's a Tucson thing.
Apparently in Tucson world and the old folks home, there's Viagra with all these men. And they're running around, hanging out with all these women.
Yeah.
And venereal disease through the roof.
So there's venereal disease. There's probably going to be more heart attacks than ever.
Yeah.
But I'm like, that's youthful lust right there. They're running around like school kids. And
yeah.
I mean, they've probably been through menopause twice, so it'd be a miracle like Sarah's day.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
But still,
it's a sin.
Sinning right out here.
It's still a sin. And so I think it's really good for us to realize that it doesn't matter what age we are, like this is the same truth that applies to everyone, because there's older people who maybe they lost their spouse or something and they get remarried or whatever. And it makes me sad because I know a lot of parents who are like living with someone or their kids see that. And think of the example, like if they're doing that, I know some people who have even come to our church where it's like, oh, but we can handle it, or we're mature now, or I've already had sex and done that. I've already have 4 kids, so it's not a big deal. What would you say to those adults
who
are talking that way? Yeah.
You mean saying they could live in a house with someone but not be physical?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the Bible says depart from the appearance of evil.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So you're generally going to be like, okay, where are you sleeping? Where are you showering? Are you not running across the room in a towel sometimes? I mean, are you not even being suggestive? It's just there.
Yeah.
And again, it goes back to the point we talked about today. Marriage isn't really about marriage. It's about God.
Mm.
Sex isn't really about sex. It's about God.
Amen.
It's not really about sin. It's about God. So if he's my dad and he knows what's best, like me telling my kids things like, don't touch this, it's hot, they might still want to because they don't know what they're getting into, but you're opening that door. And again, you're not having sex to gain salvation, but if you trust Jesus, it's not that I say I'm a Christian, it's that I want to follow him as I preach this morning, flee from it. And I would just tell people, like you told me, you know, even earlier, this younger couple, they came to a church, they connected, they were living together, and suddenly they moved out or said no to, you know, hooking up because they wanted to honor God.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot of couples like that.
Mm-hmm.
A guy in our gym doing jiu-jitsu and he brought a girl to church. They were kind of hanging out. He was going somewhere. He had a prior relationship, a marriage years ago that fell apart. And he got so fired up for his faith and said, hey, we can't be physical.
Mm.
She bailed.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm like, so, okay, well, maybe if they had got married, she would have been way more vulnerable to cheat or do whatever or just have a crazy lustful thoughts all the time. So
I
think I love the story. It's kind of where this Christian guy and girl were living together as roommates, And the mom was a strong Christian, goes, I'm not buying this. And so all of a sudden she stayed with them for a week, and they both were in their separate rooms. And then all of a sudden she left, and the daughter goes, I think it was the daughter, said, Mom, have you seen the soup ladle? We can't find our soup ladle. And she goes, well, if you were sleeping in your bed, you'd realize it's under your pillow.
Oh, so that's funny.
How true that was, but that's kind of
yeah. And they say that the statistic of marriages failing if they lived together before. I mean, I know a lot of my friends or people I went to school with, like, divorce goes like up the roof, and so it just that God's way isn't just to restrict us from like having fun, or he's a killjoy.
Yeah,
he's protecting us.
It's a less of honoring the covenant, because if you go in honoring it, you're gonna walk. Yeah. And you know what's funny is, I have a couple of Catholic families out in Texas, and I'd never really been around very serious committed Catholics. And the way they reverence marriage is amazing.
Oh, yeah.
They're like, it's a vocation. Yeah. I am this person's spouse. This is something I give myself to, where I was like, wow, if more Christians were as committed to this the way they are, not legalistic, but it sounded like, man, this is how it is. I am vowing my body to this person, not in an abusive way, but I'm like, that's how they look at it.
Yeah.
That's going to change everything. Yep. Yeah. When you're in work, because nowadays everyone's flirting in the workplace, flirting on the job site, flirting wherever, you're not going to see that anymore, because you're taking care of each other at home, and the passion's there and all the rest. And
One of the questions that the young adults had is, so if you have the accountability, you have the people around you, you know, like, you don't want to have, it's not even that you don't want to have sex, you just know, like, you also fear God, and there's like a fear of God, there's a and a love for God, because I think it's just like, when you love him, it says you'll obey his commandments, and that's a command. So I think what the question is basically, if you do want to get married and there is someone you like, how do you respond to that? Because like you said, you don't want to just be a flirt, and but
that's a good
what
question.
Should you do? Yeah.
Well, you're generally going to get a feeling. I mean, you're talking about a hypothetical situation, but in real life, I was the one asking a question. I probably already know what she looks like, how pretty she is, how attractive she is. And in a way, like Song of Songs says, she's thinking, oh, that he would kiss me on the lips. She's having thoughts. He's aware of it. So you're not lusting per se. You're not like going into sin for it. But I do think you're going to have these feelings where you consider, and maybe you text a bit longer and you talk a bit longer and you walk closer to them and you miss them when they're not around. And then it's kind of, as a man, okay, am I going to ask this person out? Am I going to go do something with some friends?
Yeah.
Or as a girl, maybe you do show interest. I mean, God put Adam to sleep, then brought Eve. In Song of Songs, she's got these feelings. Yeah, the whoa, man. Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. But then you've got later on, the man in Song of Songs is who pursues her.
Yeah.
So I would say, if it was me, here's the thing. If it was me and I liked her, she's going to know. She's going to feel it. She's going to see me pursuing. She's going to see me whatever. But to the point where I'm saying crass or stupid things, or, oh, I'd love to do this and that if we were married. Like, of course not. Honoring her, she's going to be honored. And she's going to feel that. And her family's going to feel it. And the church is going to feel it. And you're going to just naturally start courting and everything. So
what do you say the guy might have a red flag? How do you work through that?
The guy with the red flags, I would say, you've got to be able to, you don't want to keep a list per se that's your list. You want to allow the God to lead people. Like for me, if it was me years ago and I'm no longer, you know, wasn't married, I'd be like, okay, Lord, I'm going to step into my call. How is this person coming alongside me? Like I said earlier, and it's more about what we're called to do and how we connect than, does she like to do this? Does she like to do that? Even her characteristics, and she might be more dominant in this area, more submissive in this area, but that's who God made her. And like Greg Laurie says, you know, I've been married to five different women, meaning over the course of what, 40 to 50 years or whatever it would be, they changed so much. Yeah. I mean, so.
And we change too, right?
And we change. How much have I changed? What would I be saying 20 years ago, 10 years ago now? So,
I heard one person say it this way, when you, or in church, hopefully your spouse is in church, right, with you. But they said, stalk them quietly for a year. You know, what I mean? Just be with them ministering
Hang
and just watch
them,
how they do stuff.
They,
you know,
interact.
What I mean?
Until
not like
you get,
not with binoculars.
Until you get married, and then you're super paranoid and they're like, Why are you doing this? Like, this is what I've always done. No.
No, but I'm just saying, you just watch how they interact with people. Cause you know, you know, this is like people on webs, like the dating sites, like they say 75% of what they say is lies. But if you watch someone day to day, it's hard. You can maybe do that.
Yeah.
You know, everyone's
put
their best foot forward, but when you watch someone for a year, it's hard to, I mean, not that someone couldn't, but it's hard to fake.
If I could go back, I would be that specific. Cause a lot of things people don't realize, like once you get married, you've got to think, does that person think about other people?
Mm.
You got to think, when you're talking about even being physical, if they're ever being physical by themselves, I mean, that's a whole other realm. I mean, and even in the book I wrote, you get to some of these later chapters and you kind of talk about that. Like, what does sex life look like between these people? You know, what is the guy thinking it's going to be like this? Is the woman thinking it's going to be like this?
Yeah.
I would go into it now, having, you know, obviously the way God restored my marriage, Tracy's my wife. But if not prior, I'd be like, I'm going to hold out until... It's I know what exactly the Lord wants. The connection's there, and I would say I feel like it's a person that I could fight with like crazy and go through it if something crazy. Like, I remember having a friend who was in his 50s, and his wife found out she was like molested as she was younger, and it wrecked her way. She didn't even know if she wanted the marriage for 3 years. Wow. If I could meet someone and knowing that even if something like that came up, but we were still committed to the Lord, the Lord's gonna get us through it. That's going to be the difference. Yeah. You know what I mean? All the rest of it, I mean,
quit on Christ,
what if someone suddenly gets sick, has body parts chopped off, as things happen, as all this stuff? I mean, that's the fallible. But the commitment to Christ is what's going to allow you to sleep overnight. I'm telling you, someone who goes around the world knowing that my wife's committed and what she's focused on.
Yeah.
I mean, texted me in a minute, you know, a minute ago because my daughter was a bit sick. Oh, now we're at your favorite place. And I'm like, what is a Target? Because that's where we just go to Target and walk around, look at Christmas stuff, whatever. So... on the same page, you know?
Yeah.
We've been through so many fights before we were believers. Now if we're committed to Christ, we're always going to make it through unless we're backslidden or reprobate or apostate or whatever you want to say.
And I was kind of thinking, too, about marriage where a lot of guys think, you know, I struggle with pornography, I've been sexual, but I'll get married. But I like what one Christian psychologist was saying. I don't know if it was Dobson, I forget who it was, but he was saying how that people then they get over sexualized and then they want to bring that into marriage and women are kind of like, whoa, they can't tell. And then because they're fed lust, they then are not satisfied with
just being physical.
Pornography comes back in marriage because, you know, everyone believes, I'll be able to do that, but then I get married and I'll be satisfied.
Yeah.
But then usually they'll come back to pornography. Mm-hmm. And that's why, I'm sure you'll agree that we should really try to be pure before we're married, not just thinking that marriage is the end all. Now it helps, like you said, to have fun. You call it what you call it, but it's like, if you're fed lust, it's going to be real hard, as you know, to just from lust to real love and sacrificial love, where it isn't just about me and happy and pleasure for me.
Well, serving people too, because I mean, you know, if I could be real, I think the first time I ever even seen pornography, I was 9. And I watched like The Exorcist, which was illegal in England. They put it on New Year's. Like my dad had this copy of it. And after it finished, this like German porno came on of this like 6'4" guy with funny hair and a mustache running around. And I'm on the couch and all my sister's friends and my parents, people have passed out. I'm like, and no one was awake. And I was like, what's this? So what did I do for the next 3 weeks? Invite all my friends over to say, you got to see this video. So I was so used to it. Yeah. Seen it my whole life, touring the world, and people are getting, you know, porno mags as you're just driving across America on tour or skate culture. You've seen so many things. It isn't just like, oh, this is a kind of woman. You could play a million scenarios in your head. And I'm saying that to say the stimulation's already there. You can create, oh, the secretary scenario or the European scenario or whatever you want to say. Hugh Hefner, way later in his life, the guy from, you know, ran Playboy and everything, he literally said he couldn't even get to a place of satisfaction without looking at videos of men.
Wow.
So this is a guy who loved women, who just thrived in lust. And so I don't, you know, I don't want to put all this in people's minds, but I'm saying it takes you like 0.3 seconds to take an image.
Yeah.
So if you're watching this, experiencing this, thinking of this, I went and spoke at a Calvary chapel once up in Lake Arrowhead and my friend came with me. I remember him telling me his wife had struggled with an addiction to porn. And I'm like prepping a message and he's hanging out in the bunk. And I was like, really? And I was thinking like, what is she even like, what would she even look at? And he's like, you know, I didn't say it like, please tell me. But I'm like, really? Like that exists? And they said 13% of women look at pornography.
And it's growing. Now
at work.
20
but that's at work. That's just like at work. Yeah. So I'm saying, so now she's watching something. He's watching something.
Yeah.
They've had all these experiences. You go get in the marriage bed, which is undefiled. Everything's possible,
yeah.
But are you trying to live out a scenario?
Yeah, exactly.
And a guy asked me once after a question time, I know we're doing questions tonight, maybe someone will ask, is it wrong for my wife to dress up like a prostitute? Mm. And I answered and said, well, what if your wife wants you to dress up like a pirate because she has a crush on Johnny Depp? Because if you're seeing some prostitute and wanting to sleep with a prostitute and so you're making your wife this fantasy, that's sin.
That's like
but if you just appreciate clothing and your wife's body, which you should, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. She's a standard of beauty. That's the marriage bed.
Yeah.
All that stuff for them is, God's fine with all that. Unless, as long as it's two yeses, you know what I mean? And I tell couples, you should be open in that area because it is a place of comfort and protection and satisfaction. And just, I mean, just mean celebrating life, you know? So.
And as long as, like you said, you're not trying to make her look like someone else, right? You enjoy.
Yeah.
Because it's like, it's crazy too. I think, I don't know if it was, who wrote it, was a Playboy model said, I feel sorry for all the women who use my, or men that use my body as the standard.
Comparing.
And he says, I've been so air, I think it was Jenny McCarthy who said, it's, my body's been so airbrushed. He said, she said,
wow,
it's just so not real. He said, I mean, not that I have a terrible body, but she goes, it's beyond, really far beyond what
but
I
even
have.
She but probably makes, is like, I wish I looked like that.
But it makes, so he says, so then you get, then men are dissatisfied because, you know, very few women look like those people, or look at least what they make them look
How
like.
How wrong is that?
So it's just, you know, and that's why we have to really be careful what we let into our minds, because then we can be dissatisfied when we shouldn't be dissatisfied. We'd be thankful because, like you said, well, you want your wife not to go, Brian, you have no hair, you have no teeth, I'm going to get a new model, right? You want her to love you.
You've been deceived. Know,
yeah, exactly.
And that's why I love, like finishing off of the verse of 2 Timothy 2:22. It tells you the things of how not to do it. So it says what the struggle is, so flee youthful passions and pursue, but then it says what to pursue. Pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace along with, and then this is, so it says, you know, what not to do, give into youthful passions. It says what to do, and then it says how to do it. It says with those who call on the Lord of pure hearts, and that's what you're saying is, like, you can't do this alone. Like, that's why guys, I feel like the most attractive thing for a girl to see a guy who is in church, who is being discipled, who, because if you see a man who's just, like, doing his own thing all by himself and he's really not getting any discipleship or growing, it is scary. Like, you do need a community. Men need a community of men. Women need sisters and girls that are going to push them, not just flatter them and say,
challenge
them. You're fine. They need to say, like, hey, you too are being – you're arousing that man. Because I think girls need to take ownership, too, of, like, putting down men. Like, I love Ali Beth Stuckey, like we're talking about. She says, like, make men masculine again. But girls are scared of that because they hear all the things of, you know, the guys dominating women, raping them. But I'm like, I'm sorry, but it's true. Think of the girls who have been, like, was it Proverbs 7? But, or been, like, the woman who is luring them in.
Yeah.
And it's, like, us as women, we can do things and we know.
Yeah.
We act like we're all innocent, but women know how to get a man and what to do until it goes too far, and then they get angry. So I think as women,
I like what Jay Vert, I think it was Jay Vert said, if you're not for sale, don't advertise.
Don't advertise.
Oh, he did. Well, you know, and here's the reality, and I said it earlier this morning before my mom passed away. She said, men exploit women, but women begin to exploit themselves. That was the idea. And so if you think about it, you have COVID going on, you have masks 6 feet apart, but on the TV, you have four women making out, dancing around a pole. You look at some of these famous women and they go, oh man, look at this woman. The women say this about her. But she's basically got a husband and kids at home, and she's shaking her rear end off on her body, dancing like a stripper. And I go, so what you're doing is you're lowering the standard. It's crazy. And you just mentioned then, even in Timothy, how it says faithfulness. Faithfulness. So can you faithfully trust in the plan of the Lord that you might court that person for 6 months, 6 years? I don't know how long. Can you trust God's plan in the midst of that? I mean, but you know, this is a walk of the Holy Spirit. You can go to church, you have a pastor, you have leadership, but this has got to be something you do. You know, we're in the tangible, so you want to hold that person, feel that person, get to an altar, but the zeal should be in walking with the presence of the Holy Spirit and Him showing you. And it's possible. I have friends who, you know, were virgins until their 30s, and I was like, praise God they did that, and then got to get married and have, you know, there's just a lot of things they're not worried about anymore.
And they're really blessed when you have that, when you're one, because then, like, whatever, I don't know what it is, the oxytocin, I think. Oxytocin, is that it? For when you grow breasts. So when a woman breastfeeds their baby, there's a lock. If you've seen little babies, how they're just like mamas, everything. That's the same thing released if you have sex wife, a woman has sex with a man, it releases, I think it's oxytocin, and it bonds them. But if you keep doing it, it lessens and lessens and lessens if you keep doing it with different men. Mm. But if it's with one man, it's a lock. And the same with a man, because man's visual, so he'll lock this. This is sensual to me. This is beautiful if it's your wife. So just that image. But you know, if you have all these other images of prostitutes and weird things hanging from chandeliers, and you kind of bring that in. You know what I mean?
It's jaded.
It's really amazing. How I want to say this and see what you think of this, but I realized with me, so I didn't have a mom or dad, and I got to be careful because I don't want to make an excuse. But I really saw, like, I struggled with sexual morality, but it was really like the old country song, looking for love in all the wrong places. And it was weird. The more I had sex before Christ, the more empty I got, because it really was just sex. It wasn't, there wasn't love. I didn't love them.
No commitment, no covenant.
You know? But you were with another woman, close, someone that really ideally you would have wanted to know as a mom, you know what I mean? Or a family member or something. And now you're out here just looking for love somewhere, but it's just a shell.
It's empty, cause, and that's what I think, too, is that I realized that sometimes, because the family is so broken down in America and the world, that sometimes we have to really, like, I really like what you said, the answer is not just I got to work on my marriage, just work. The answer is a relationship with God. And like the triangle, have you heard that? As you grow close to God, you grow close to your spouse. But to also, like you're saying, being single, to prepare for marriage, to be holy now, to find your satisfaction in Christ now, be content. Remember, Paul says, if you're married, I live like you're single. So it's like, it's always, and if you're, you know, a lot of single people want to, I'll be happy when I'm married.
Translation, you know? The Message translation, of those verses, 1 Corinthians 7, is amazing. The read talks about the nuts and bolts. But even just thinking of Mariah, I mean, imagine when you meet a spouse, we're going to know this is serious. When you're getting married on that day, this is like your commitment. This isn't just like, oh, some other guy that you're hanging out with and whatever. This is like, it's on. You know, that's going to be a big deal.
Like you
deal.
Said, sadly, even in the church, it's not really, it's like optional. Like you say, how many people do you know that say, well, we just grew out of love? And I love what Greg Laurie, you know, I love what Greg Laurie says. When someone says you usually grew out of love, then what are you loving now? Usually there's something else you love. But it's like, you know, or like Egridge said, it's because you were, you know, there's volatile couples, and there's, what was the other one? What was it? Passive? I forget what it was, where they never talk. And they say, I've been together for 50 years. We never fought. And that's the couple all of a sudden.
That's because.
He says they'll just say, I don't love you anymore. Yeah. But it's like, you know, you need to, like you said, fight fair. And be careful what we say, because our wives are historical, as they say. They'll remember. But it's like, but you want to be able to, you got to get it out, you know.
So. And not having your love be conditional, because that's what it is now. It's like you were bringing up in the, your message is like, you do this for me, I'll do that for you. And I love this one saying, they're like, if you want a good marriage, is you need to outdo them in service. Like, you need to know too that it's almost better if they treat you bad, because know that you'll be defended in heaven. Like, God will take care of it. If you do your part to outdo them in service, to love them, even though, like, you don't, they don't deserve it or whatever, you could be thinking, because technically you don't either. So it's like, can't be hypocritical in that. But I mean, the best advice I feel like I was given was that when someone was saying, practice that now, because I could easily be like, because when you're dating or whenever I've been courting, you're so like goo goo gaga that you feel like, oh, I for sure will like do whatever for them, and it's gonna be so easy, because you're in like and then you're
well the honeymoon stage, and you're like in the warm fuzzies, and then life hits, and you know, my wife, you weren't Christian yet, so I was just like, yeah, just stop working and stay home with me. So imagine if we had kids then, and then we had like a life that actually needed things to get done. Nothing would get done. You have to live in the real world, and that's responsibility, and that's, you relate in the struggles then.
And that's why you have to do it now. And so what the advice for single people that I've heard someone say is, don't be this independent boss babe, because that's what girls are being taught, or guys, like, just be independent, go fishing, go golfing, do what you want, and then maybe they'll come. No, what you need to do is you follow the call that God has for you. You do that like full, all out, like running for the Lord, but still looking, and you're not just
prepare
like
yourself,
prepared,
see who's
are, being ready to serve, because you're already serving others. So when that person comes in, that for the woman, right, you need to find a man that you're like, hey, I really respect this man. And men, you need to find a woman that you truly are like, I would die, like true love, right? Love is to be able to, you would lay your life down for this woman. And so if you can do that, because right, Egridge, he always says it's a crazy cycle. You're like, he doesn't like love me, and she doesn't respect me, but like, I love how it says someone needs to be the bigger person. So whoever out there is thinking, well, if only my husband did this, then I'll do this. well, if you think you're the more mature one, then be the more mature one and you do it. Mm-hmm. But it's easier said than done. But again, you said, you need the Holy Spirit. Like, without the Holy Spirit, because my dad always says, like, why is love so hard? Because we have all our young adults and all of them are single. And I love our young adults because we're not like a singles ministry. We're all just serving God.
Yeah.
And we always joke because, like, a lot of us, like, really, we're like, hey, we really... Because we need to remember, too, we're not just saying if you're single and love God and you're single and love God, you automatically should. Mm. I mean, you also need to know, too, the Holy Spirit, like, he will bring that together. But at the same time, I think we really do overcomplicate things and we overthink things. Like, you were telling me, you're like, because I was asking you, I was like, so do you believe in, like, compatibility or whatever? And, like, the end thing that you came to me said is, like, no, I believe that there's a call, like specific people. Mm. Like if one girl
Ephesians
was called.
Ephesians 2:10. You are given a specific set of rules. So I look at you in the placement of your family and you organize stuff and you commit to stuff and you execute stuff. And then there's a guy who's like, he's got this zeal and he's got what he's doing. Mm-hmm. How does that mesh together rather than do we like the angels or do we play video games or do we do
like
this?
Music.
That can always change. I mean, when I fell in love with my wife, we were listening to the Misfits and the Ramones at the time and certain songs that matter to us.
Yeah.
But now it's more. And it's just silly stuff like this. My kids, for some reason, are super hyper afraid of homeless people, which is, and I mean the crazy homeless people in Huntington, you know, kind of chase you around trash cans. Not just homeless people, they help them all the time. But I just, coming back from church one day, and we just go around the shopping center, and they come running up like, Dad, Dad. I'm like, what? And like, it's Mom, what? And they're like, Dad. And they're like, it's the homeless person, what? She's buying them pizza. And I was like, that's hot. Like, that's like, what am I, 22 years in a marriage in December? That's hot. Like, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, you can wear whatever, you can dress whatever. Everyone's body's out there. Everyone's on display. Think about how crazy that it used to be years ago. Mm. All the Greek sculptors were very large women. Then you got this whole Baywatch body thing. Then you got super scrawny. Now you've got like almost getting buff. Like, so is the enemy just fluctuating what is supposed to be attractive, and likewise it's just thrown in people's faces? So like, is it just like bait over people? And to me, like, that stuff's gonna fade, but to have someone that's by your side, that's there. I want to be able to go to sleep without headaches, without having to fight. And if we're going to fight, it's got to be about something that's relevant and something that one of us misunderstood. And that's that's Bible too.
It's like it's like Bob Dylan said it when he did his little Christian set. He said, I want a God-fearing woman, one I can easily afford. So that was pretty good.
That's Proverbs 31 right there. She can be trusted in the marketplace. Yeah. Does some good all the days of her life. I mean, who can find? You know?
And you brought up too the woman like in 1 Peter, like, I think, my encouragement to any woman out there, and this is something I struggle with, and I've seen it, because women can get this pride, well, there's no good men out there, or whatever they could think. Like, I've been tempted with that. But what I was just admitting to my dad, and I think there's like some of our women at the church too, we're really strong women, but we got to be careful, because Bible talks about quiet, gentle spirit. And I catch myself sometimes just being like, independent, like, I can do this, like, I'm strong, like, I have an AR-15, I have all these guns, like,
but you're
not
called to do it. If you're called not to be single, there's going to be a spouse for you. And that's the, and you got to think this to encourage you, Mariah, is that at this time in life, you could go, oh, well, if it was 30 years ago, that Christian guy would be around somewhere, like the generation prior. But if you're called to be married now, God's got that person out there somewhere. And I would say to people saying, I've got to find the right godly person, make yourself the godly person to be a bless to someone. And guys, be serious in this, the checklist, in a sense, it should be, has this person been sleeping with people? What are their issues? What are their addictions? What is their family history? It's about the call. It's about love. God's the one at work, but you want to know, what am I getting into? Like, you're someone that's very called and driven to do things. If you got into a relationship with a guy who just had major addictions and you could never actually live into what you've been raised to live into, it's going to be a massive burden for your life.
Exactly.
Can you, Brian? I don't know if you want to ask this, but you know, like we say, you know, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom, his righteousness, all these things will be added to you. Yeah. And it's funny we say that, but then we don't believe. And then you hear people like, I think it was Andy Stanley, sorry, I'm about a dog. Yeah. But he says, you know, I hate all these little churches because you need big churches because there's so many. And, you know, a lot of people, why do people like going to the big church? Because amenities, which does the Bible talk about coffee bars and stuff like that?
Yeah.
But really, what did you say today?
Yeah.
Go and make disciples. Well, you didn't say it. Jesus said, but you quoted, go and make disciples. So, can you speak to trusting God? Like,
you know, because
we're a small church, maybe if everyone showed 300 people, but you know, you know, but there's that kind of weird thing of like, you got to go to the big church to get, and I'm not dogging big church. You hear what I'm saying? But I mean, we just, I think you were saying that just a second ago about trusting God that if you're seeking first the kingdom, you're living, if you're fulfilling the call for you, then God in his timing, right?
Well, I would look at the pedigree that's in your church. You know, I didn't know that Mariah, I mean, your son and his wife and everyone was doing worship. I didn't see the ins and outs of all the church, but I'm like, there's a pedigree here where people have been discipled that it would be hard to come and be in the midst of the church and get by on a bunch of fluff. Like, you would find out pretty quick. Oh, remember the old church, there was a guy that came in, and I don't know how, over the course of like 4 or 5 years, got 3 different women like pregnant. I'm like, that's when you kind of need like a membership. Like, what's going on? The danger with a big church is, I talked about it today, you know, you've got this kind of seeker friendly, you've got this momentum driven, a lot of programs are good, but are those people actually living the call? I mean, we could totally drop this whole conversation now, and if people said, what is Christianity? And I said it this morning, a Jewish carpenter rabbi called a bunch of fishermen and he taught them his yoke. Yoke is his teaching. He's a fisher of men. The term fisher of men, you go to Harvard, you go to Princeton, you go to hear a Martin Luther King, you go to hear whoever you want to say, their speeches, they're catching your ears. That's a fisher of men. Jesus is teaching. That has been multiplied. I mean, not that it's a pyramid scheme, but it's the greatest way to plan. It's mouth by mouth, you know, heart to heart, Holy Spirit driven. So now you get to a church of this size where probably everyone I've seen, when I come back, I'll remember them. Now, it's a big church. I'm not going to, you know, knock big churches, but a lot of times you don't know who's there. And I don't know who's really involved in serving where, because they're showing up for, you know, an hour from 30 minutes away. So I would say it's more about the faith and where God has you. I listed those things today that were very relevant. You know, the first thing is like praying and worship. I can pray with you guys. I can pray with those who are watching. But can I humbly pray with my wife? We talked about reading the Bible. Times he went through really hard seasons. My mom passing away. My wife miscarrying. Transitioning out of a church. That nightly reading together for even 10, 15 minutes. That's something most couples don't even do once a week. We take care of our, you know, bank accounts. Take care of our bodies. Take care of our jujitsu. Take care of our podcast. But how focused am I on my spouse? The third thing was, do we even play together? Are we even physical together anymore? Do couples do that? And then the last thing was, do we serve? I came to faith in 2004. God didn't rapture me out of here. I'm here for a reason. So as I serve him, be it a big, if God ever said, I want you, I don't ever want to be a lead pastor. It scares me. I like being an evangelist. That's a lot of decisions. But if suddenly I had a church, it was a big church, I'd be like, this is only relevant if the people here can know each other enough to serve communities, which is what you have here. 300 people is a great amount of people to know that when the right person comes in that you're going to marry, or the next person comes in for your other daughter, for whatever it is. But it's all trusting. You don't need to go to a big church to find someone who might have a shallower faith. And that sounds empty, but, you know.
And that's what you were saying, too, is that, like, what I always like to quote is, he said, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, Son. But the New Living says, and teach them to obey all that I commanded you. And you see that, right? There's a lot of people profess Christ that are fornicating, have no problem with it. Not a struggle.
And like, no one knows they're doing it.
Because it's so big. And they come in late, leave early, so there's no accountability. They have no one can speak in their life. And that's where I think, that's where I kind of dog, and I can dog it because I was at the biggest church in this town, church of probably, you know, at this is back in the 80s, but it was like 3,600, 3,700 people. And, you know, this was a smaller town then. But, you know, it's easier to slip in, and sometimes I saw that when I was kind of going through a hard time in ministry. I just went to a really big church in town here, and I just went in late, left early.
Because you didn't want to be bothered with it. You want to deal with it.
I stamped my card so I could say,
but also I don't know what donuts you're eating. I don't know what, and you know, and I'll speak to it like this. Our church is a fair-sized church, like 3 or 4 services sometimes. And for my son, you've got to think, okay, these kids who are coming through the youth group, they're the youth leaders. two or three years after, are they the ones who are drinking and chasing a wife and sleeping with different people in the church?
Yeah.
Because now you become almost sexually explicit. Now the generation below is looking at you. For me, if I see something like that going on, I'm super open about, like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
You're setting a standard to kids and youth. And I'm not saying that's what's happening, you know, for our home church, but you want to. Paul could write letters and he could address people in those churches.
Yep.
So he knew their names. I'm not saying he knows everyone. You know, Joe Smo walked in today. Mm-hmm. But you should pastorally, as a shepherding group, whether you believe in the fivefold ministry for today or not, with elders, pastors, all the rest, it's there as well. Yeah. You should know what's going on. Know these people.
Know the state of your flock.
Yeah. And I say this because, and you guys both know this, but that podcast, The Rise and Fall of Mars Hill, it's a dangerous thing to want a big church. Mm-hmm. You hear those podcasts, you know, and it talks about how those churches exploded. You go plant a church in an area that is thriving and growing. You make it everything people want it to be. Mm-hmm. And people will drive 30 minutes to come to your mega church.
Yeah.
And you will be very famous, sell a lot of books, but maybe not do that much one-to-one ministry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's dangerous.
Yeah. And also what it is, we talked about this last week, but what it is too is, think about this. I talk to pastors. I talk to, I could say some, but a church was like this one in Phoenix, about 15,000 people. And I said, he was doing multiple campuses. I go, when is it big enough? I'm going, out of 15,000 people, you can't raise up one other person to take the other campus.
Yeah.
I mean, think about it. But why? Because you want to be, you know, Brian Sumner Ministries. You know, we want this big thing. And it's like, what does the Bible say in James 3:14? Yeah. He says, wherever there's selfish ambition or jealous and bitter envy, there's earthy and spiritual demonic. And so sometimes we can say, oh, it's for the Lord. Mm-hmm. But really, it's for Craig's kingdom to make me feel
Ephesians
great.
Well, Ephesians says, apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, our gift to the church for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. So who are you equipping and who's being sent out into the ministry?
Yeah. Because think what Jesus would do. If you really follow that paradigm, Jesus would say, okay, Brian, you're stupid. Greg's stupid. So what I'm going to do, you get a group
and,
I'll translate. I'll just translate myself into the group and you just get them together.
Together.
I mean, if Jesus trusted you and I to be in ministry, why can't we trust someone? Why can't
some
we
fishermen
raise up?
You know, didn't know what to do. They didn't have Craigslist, didn't have a PhD. Could they even read right, but they would have.
But they know that they've been with Jesus. They know they saw a difference.
And,
you know, you've seen that meme. You know, it was a meme of Skeletor, and it's like him running up to the screen, and he says, "The Old Testament was an audio book," and he just runs off. And I'm like, "That's funny because it was, you know, spoke orally, and people knew it."
Yeah.
So in Jesus's day, you've got to think they would have heard these teachings. They would have known these things. They would have known enough that they saw in him who he was meant to be, which the religious leaders are missing it. So I'm not here to dog all that stuff. You know, I know you're not, but the bigger churches have got to be careful, because if it's a one-man show, I praise God that at our church there is a board, there are people who hold our lead pastor, everyone accountable, and he wants that. The dangers of just doing whatever.
And it's dangerous because where does it talk about where men come in and they go after weak women?
Throughout,
But if you are doing that, If you have such a big church where you don't know
what's happening
and that's happening to a woman or something, and the head pastor isn't able to rebuke her, say, that's when it's getting scary. Mm-hmm. To where you need to be able to see if you see a young man or someone doing something. Mm-hmm. I mean, because in big churches, you know that's happening.
Shepherd the flock. Yeah. You know them. A shepherd knew his flock. And you heard it said before.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, one of the best books I ever read was by Eugene Peterson, and it's called Pastor. And in that book, you know, he's passed away now. He's the guy who translated the Message. But it's amazing. I'm going to read it when I get home. I think I said it last time I talked to you guys, but I'm actually going to do it this time. But he said, don't think of yourselves so highly as pastors because you're a shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
And if a dog can do your job, you know what I mean? And he says it in such a respectful way, but he's talking about Abraham, Moses, David. I mean, all these things, lowly and humble positions. And
that's true.
And I heard, you know, John Corson too.
Of course. Yeah.
But John Corson said, what she was quoting about David being 50, he's probably thinking, well, I'm 50. I'm done with the youthful lust thing. Mm-hmm. And look what happened with Bathsheba.
Yep.
So it's like, we can never think we're too old to do this. Or we've been there, done that, or been married before. So
or I'm young,
I
get to experience it.
So we have to always, you know, like it says in 1 Corinthians 11, judge yourself rightly and you'll not be judged.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's good to kind of, like, how I remain pure is because I know I could.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore I don't give, I'm not alone with the woman. People get mad at me.
Idle,
why are you alone? Because I don't want to be tempted with that. If I'm not alone with a woman, I'm not going to have a problem by the grace of God. You know what I mean? But if I counsel a woman alone in this room, that's not my wife,
yeah,
then there could be problems. Because if only my husband was like you, you know. So we have to, we just,
and
I think
people
sometimes
don't realize
we have to
that.
Be weak to be strong.
Women
like
are
Paul
different.
Says.
I've noticed even before I was a believer, if I was around someone and it's like their husband wasn't around or the boyfriend, they'd be different.
Yeah.
And whether it was just to get your attention, because when I go into Starbucks, that girl got up today and put her makeup on and put her scent on and put her hair on to look presentable, whether she's trying to get attention or not. So if you wanted to get girls, you just be like, oh, go give her any kind of attention, because she already set herself up for that.
Yeah.
And like I said, from my mom's point that women exploit themselves, sadly, women now go out and parade themselves, and then they hang out with this guy and put it all on display. And the guy hangs out, they, you know what? And she's like, he played me. Did he though?
Yeah, exactly.
You kind of presented all of this, and they go, well, that guy's insecure because I shouldn't put it all on display. And I'm like, I get what you're saying, but if that's the first thing he's thinking and he's willing to go there, for one, that's the kind of man he is, so why are you going there? And for two, why give him the opportunity?
And I always tell women, and this is like thing, and then we have to end it because the pastor and I have to be at worship practice.
I get it.
And we have our Q&A tonight, which that will be on.
You're so type A.
Sorry. Yeah. But Kevin's the one. I know he's wanting us to finish. But I tell women too, like, and this is for men and women, we need to be intentional and ask the Holy Spirit. Like, it's a relationship with God. It's not a religion, or like, because I've struggled with religion. I say, I can't do this. I can't do that. I have to do this. But when I wake up in the morning, like, I should be able to ask the Lord, like, Lord, what do you want me to wear? Because if I'm trying to wear this and thinking, oh, so-and-so will see this, or they'll like this, or I'll relate to them, because, right, try and have a relationship with a person, that's wrong, and that's idolatry. But if I'm saying, God, what do you want me to wear? How do you want, what do you want me to eat? Like, if it's just communication with God, he will put you in the path. Like what you said in Psalm, it's like, in Psalms, is it 3? Or I'm totally, never mind. But trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean on your own understandings, and all your way acknowledge him, and he will direct your path or make your path straight. But
it is 3:5-8
Anyway, I don't know, but I think we're getting in our goofy phase, and we have to finish it. But
we're saying to all the singles, don't go there. Be loving, be kind,
and in a good community.
Wait on the Lord. Let him do what he's doing. And guys, listen, if you've had all these experiences, then repent and give them to the Lord. Amen. You are not broken, cast away. Mm-mm. God will give your spouse grace, you know, one day, and he'll understand, or she'll understand. That's not it. There's no condemnation. But get in with the Lord and what he's doing. Focus on what he's called you to do. And, and you know, pray those prayers. Lord, bring me my spouse. I mean, he might not. Let him do it when he's doing it. But if that's really what's on your heart, Lord, I just want to know what my life's going to look like, but pray that you'd be patient in that too.
Make your
like
request
you said,
to God.
Is that I really like what you said, but, you know, let him clean you up, or let him, you know, do that. Because sometimes too, when you've already blown it, you think, oh, I've already done it, I might as well keep, you know, good. Satan does that. And it's like, no, you know, today, you know, you can, forgetting what lies behind, press on to life, be a new creation. Don't think I've already jacked it up.
Don't add to those
so
experiences.
You know, it's like,
repent,
oh, I cut my, I got
away.
Cactus in my finger, I might as well chop my hand off. No, stop. You know,
I know.
Like, stop stop messing with, you know.
I think it's all gone now.
Yeah, that's good.
Brian and Cactus.
But where can our guests find your book and your resources?
It's called Never Fails. If you type Never Fails, Brian Sumner, it's on Amazon. It will all be on briansumner.net soon. I do the Foolishness podcast. That's just anywhere. It's on YouTube as well. I need to be more intentional about a YouTube channel, but I'm traveling around doing other stuff. And that's it. I'm just doing evangelism, ministry, living life. And I don't like to be too intentional about creating a Brian culture where I design everything and have all this stuff and it's me. But I do realize there's people around the world, because of my skate career, because of growing up in England, because of all the traveling, and now because as a believer, they're interested in what I'm doing. So if I can put stuff out, they came across this because they searched me and found you guys. They want to get that book or connect with me on Instagram, just Brian Sumner.
Yeah,
I'm generally available to most anyone, unless they're crazy and harass and have all kinds of legalistic issues, and I'm like, I haven't
got
time.
You'll cut them off from the idolatry and block them.
Yeah, and it's not because, it's just because I just don't have the time. But people, I get on the phone with some people for a couple hours, I don't even know, because I feel like God's working on them. So
amen.
That's what we really appreciate about you. Even though you've been a famous skateboarder, you're still real. You're a real dude. You know,
I was suicidal. I need to be able to be in people's lives where I can help them, yeah. you know? So,
because, yeah, amen. Freely you've been given, now freely give. Yeah. God helped you, yeah. helped me out the same way. Yeah. So it's like, that's why Mariah says you have such a heart for people. I go, well, I didn't before Jesus, mm-hmm. but because forgive I know he snatched me out of the miry pit.
Yeah.
I want to be used by God to help others amen. Out of the pit, you know?
Would you like to pray for our listeners?
Of course. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hey, Jesus. It's about you, mm-hmm. and we use a Bible, and we talk about being pastors and ministry and churches, and these are all things that you use and offices you've ordained, but it's about a relationship with you,
yes, Jesus.
And that no one listening would be hearing, well, if I do this and do that, God will be happy with
mm-hmm.
me.
Mm-hmm.
God so loved the world that he sent his son to mm-hmm. die for you. Mm-hmm. And religion in its proper understanding is a hedge of protection.
Mm.
It's given to help us, to protect us, like a password on a bank account or like a lock on a door. And God knows what is best for you. And if you take that and say, Lord, this podcast wound me up a bit. Some of these verses challenge me. I just want to go live my own way, seeking my kingdom. That, Lord, you would help them in this season to seek first your yes, kingdom, Lord. Your righteousness. They would learn to trust in you in a holy way. God, we struggle. The flesh is weak, but the spirit is strong. And amen. Romans 8:14 says, as many as are led by the spirit of God are the sons mm-hmm. of God, the daughters of God. So I pray that where there's conviction there, where there's sin, where there's pain, where there's hurt, God, release that as they repent, free them, help them to understand, God, your blood washes us clean. But Lord, lead them into their marriages. Lead them into what's next. If they don't have this gift, like the Apostle Paul says he had, then show them who their spouse will be. Mm. But most importantly, lead them into the call to follow you and fish for men, to go into all the world and make disciples, and to be full of your spirit, the love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control that comes with the fruit of the Spirit. Do a work in your listeners. We pray for tonight's service. And Mariah, as she darts off to a worship practice, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us on Calvary Conversations. If you haven't already, please make sure to like, subscribe, and share this video. If you like to listen to us wherever you get your podcast, just type in Calvary Conversations. You can also follow us on Instagram to check out our behind the scenes at Calvary Conversations. Thanks so much to our sponsor, Mission Heating and Cooling. Please make sure to check out their website in the description below. And don't forget to get Brian Sumner's book, Never Fails. And you can get that at briansumner.net. All of that is in the description below. Thanks so much, guys, and God bless.
Found it. Watch out for cactuses.